Well, then it's simple. You're both going to hell.
No way, this is bogus, man.
But you don't understand. I need this drink.
No, I just could weaken.
You're the one who had the drinking problem.
You've been sober for years now, right?
What does being normal and healthy, you know, what does that mean?
Welcome, everybody, to the Edward T. Martin Show featuring the great Hilary Kemp. Yeah, that's right. Edward T. Martin Show comes to you live on MP3 from a secret, super secret location in the Mountain Time Zone and from the first floor of the Kemp residence in Shoreline, Washington, from Hilary's bed. Is that right, Hilary?
That's right.
All right, we'll get to that in just a bit, but let us tell you a little bit about ourselves and how to contact us. We are the only show that's politically correct, sustainable, fair trade, shade grown, eco-friendly, organic, locally produced, recyclable, gay-friendly, carbon neutral, low flow, compostable, cage-free, namaste blessed, grassroots, and community-oriented. You know why? Because one half of this show comes to you from Seattle, Washington. The Hell Hole Haven for holistic homeopathic healers, hoods and hoodies, histrionic harlots, herbivores and hermits, hemp-using hippies, hypocritical unhandy hipsters, homeless heretics, harlequins, and hedonists. You know, Hilary, at this point, I usually ask you if you are one of those, but it's probably more fair to say I am probably half of those, if not most of them. These days, the other half of our show comes to you from the land of the 1876 gold rush, Redneck Central, the Mile High City, land of four-wheel drives, SUVs, and pickups with gun racks in the back windows. So awesome. Home of the Denver Broncos and their rabid and retarded fans. And let me clarify, by retarded, I mean backwards, as in like if you're setting the timing on your engine on your car. If it doesn't have electronic ignition and fuel injection, you would either retard or advance the timing on your car. So when I use the word retarded, I mean backwards. Okay. Yes, the Denver Broncos and their retarded fans. And speaking of retards, home of the fine and fun people who put the mental into fundamentalists and take the fun out of it. Yes, that's right. The right-wing Christians. Denver, Colorado is where I'm at. I'm Edward T. Martin, former professional broadcaster with a Ted Baxter voice. And if you don't know who Ted Baxter is, you're probably under the age of 50. Former traffic reporter, now a receptionist for a small law firm and all-around critic specializing in film, television, radio, newspapers, and magazines. Actually, I'm a legal assistant now, so there you go. Or as Hilary once put it, everything that is dying. Thanks, Hilary. And Hilary is actually Dr. Hilary Kemp. She is a research scientist and has a PhD in molecular biology and works at the previously mentioned Fred Hutchinson Cancer Research Center and also works for the University of Washington. Actually, I think that's out of date. You don't work at the Hutch anymore, do you?
I do not work at the Hutch anymore.
Yeah, I need to update my script. Well, if you want to find our show, if you're listening to this, say, on the website, you know what? You can also find us at Stitcher.com. Stitcher.com is the place to go. Go there and download the Stitcher app or just listen to Stitcher right there on the website. But it's mainly made for mobile phones and to use as an app. And turns out Stitcher is so darn good. They won something. Is that right, Hilary?
Indeed. It won the TechCrunch Top 20 App Award and is now recognized as a leader in helping to define the future of radio. And what I think is kind of cool is that the number of people downloading Stitcher and integrating it into their cars is in the millions.
Seriously?
It's now 8 million people downloading and 4 million cars on the road with Stitcher.
4 million cars on the road with Stitcher. That's fantastic because there's the population of the United States, what, like 300 million, right? And not everyone owns a car, so... almost every car in the world, in the United States, has a radio in it, but now 4 million of those have Stitcher.
That's right. Stitcher is awesome. We're in the actual digits of percentages.
Yeah, right on. Yeah, Stitcher's awesome. How does it feel as a listener of this show, you know who I'm talking about, you the listener, how does it feel to have been with us from the beginning of Stitcher, which we were? We were, I wouldn't say we were one of the first acts on Stitcher, but we were there when they were very young and in the beginning, as we were young and in the beginning. And look at them grow. Stitcher is awesome. Get it at Stitcher.com. Anyway, if you want to give us a call, you can do that. The number here is 660-386. Sean Connery, 007-7. And that's the Chicago way. Well, no, that's not the Chicago way, but that is the phone number, Sean Connery. Thank you very much for doing that for us, Sean. 660-386-0077. You can call that number and leave a message as Hayden McManus did. Man, I'll tell you what, Hilary, we ought to just call this show the Hayden McManus Show. Man, she is all over this one, man. She is following us like a shadow on a person in the sun. Do you want to hear her message?
I do.
All right, I'm going to play it right now for you and the folks at home. Here we go.
Hello, Edward T. and Hilary. This is Hayden, again, your number one fan. I actually have a whole bunch of stuff to talk about, so hopefully you can leave, you know, like half the show for me to fill up with various portions of this message. First of all, guilty pleasures. For me, it tends to also be television. I think television sort of lends itself to guilty pleasure-ness, but I tend to watch, not so much today, but back in the 90s, Disney Channel shows. Anything that my inner 14-year-old girl would really love.
What do you think about that, Hilary? About the inner 14-year-old girl.
What do I think about being 14? I didn't really enjoy it, so... You know, I didn't watch a lot of TV when I was younger.
Because for me, she hit on something. When she said that, all of a sudden it hit me. Like a lot of the stuff that I find guilty pleasures, I realized that my like inside me, I feel like I am about 14 years old, like right before puberty.
Do you feel like you're a 14-year-old girl, though?
Yes, absolutely.
All right.
I mean, no, wait, what? no, but I feel like I'm in that sweet spot where you're smart enough to have figured out a whole lot about the world and how the world works. And if you're me, you're smarter than any of the adults around you by that point. And yet innocent enough that puberty hasn't hit. And at least for a guy, you're not all consumed by your raging hormones yet. So the world's a pretty cool place at that point. And you're still pretty innocent, you know, like you haven't experienced your first heartbreak or, you know, for me, like getting punched out or, you know, or the mean things that people say or your horrible jobs that are ahead of you and all these other rotten things that are coming your way that you don't know they're coming your way. So it's a really great place. So a lot of my guilty pleasures, I think, take me back to that spot. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I totally hear what you're saying. Do not relate to it at all.
You're kidding me. Wow, what a great shock that you and I completely disagree on something.
I mean, it's a different kind of disagreement. I don't disagree with you philosophically because I can't. You're telling me your experience and I believe you, so I'm not disagreeing with your experience, but I certainly didn't have it. I found my life very difficult until I left home. And
really?
Definitely there were good things. I'm not saying it was all bad, but
yeah,
I found my teenagers in particular quite difficult. And sure, yeah, 14 actually is about the right time for me. I was just hitting puberty then. So, you know, I had a good friendship. That was nice. I was doing pretty well in school, but I was just at the start of when things started to slowly improve. So I don't know. Huh. 14 would not be my like most favorite year to look back on. Not at all. As for guilty pleasures, I would say my guilty pleasures probably stem back to like when I was 5 or 6. So
seriously?
Yeah.
How come?
I don't know how come. Maybe that age, 5 or 6, is when I was developing guilt. So
what?
the sense of guilt kind of, I can kind of go back to that place.
I don't understand what you mean. Your sweet spot was 5 years old when you developed guilt. That's what I got out of that statement.
No, no, no. I'm saying she was talking about guilty pleasures and what they're, where they stem from. You're talking about your guilty pleasures and where they stem from. I would say that, I mean, when I use the word guilty pleasure, there is actual guilt associated with that pleasure. It's something that I do that I kind of feel might not be quite sanctionable, or maybe.
I think you're overthinking it a little bit too much. That by guilty pleasure, as usual, we're going to have to set some definitions here. By guilty pleasure, guilty pleasure is a term that's bandied about a lot in media, among popular media like movies and television shows and music. The first time I ever heard the term was I was reading an article in the British Film Institute magazine called Sight and Sound, which I used to get imported at the, how long ago it was, I used to get it imported at one of the newsstands in downtown Denver. And one of the magazines had an interview with Wim Wenders, who made one of my all-time favorite films called Wings of Desire. And he's a pretty well-known art film maker, you know, maker of art films. And the article title was Wim Wenders' Guilty Pleasures. And so he listed these films that you would not think a guy like him, who is so incredibly creative and imaginative, you would not think he liked. Now, unfortunately, I can't remember any of the films because most of them are from like the 30s and 40s. It would be something like Herbie the Love Bug or something like that was his guilty pleasure. So that's what.
Which, by the way, is an awesome film.
It is. It really does cry. I love Herbie. I was so scared when that car split apart in half and Tennessee roars past the front of the car. And can I say that Michelle Lee was the most beautiful woman on the face of the planet at that time? I think that's where I got my hankering for brunette-haired women, which blew up in my face later on. Regardless, so that's what I'm talking about when I say guilty pleasures. Does that help you out at all?
Well, you know, I think here's my main problem is I'm not sure that I could trace mine to a particular age.
Yeah.
Really, that's the simplest way to put it. I think it comes from all over the place. I mean, one of the things that I remember we talked about was that I secretly like country music, and I don't know when that happened. Where is that from? I have no idea. Welcome to Earth, third rock from the
sun. Yeah, but you said that was from... You said that was because of the beat to it, and you could dance to it.
Well,
right?
That's why I realized that I like it. You know, as an adult, that's why I finally finally acknowledged and accepted that I like it. But, you know, the truth is, I've liked it for a while, and I just kind of kept that a secret from myself. And that, I mean, I was exposed to it a lot because I came from Alberta, you know, and there's country music there. So.
Sure. Just like Denver. Yeehaw! Shoot them up. Yeehaw. All right. Well, let's continue to listen to this message here. Where am I? Right there. Okay. Here we go.
Also teen books. Maybe Harry Potter even counts as a guilty pleasure. Although, see, I tend to think that it's kind of cool, even though lots of people think it's dorky. So there you have that for that one. And, okay, I have to disagree with you on the topic of Christianity. I know that you tend to over-exaggerate things, and maybe that you don't...
Wait a second. I'm pausing this thing again. I am getting tired of this over-exaggeration label. I've about had it. So I'm calling bogus on that. I have been going to see a therapist, and I've been telling her about my experiences, and I talk with her the way I talk with anybody else, and she does not think I exaggerate, so... When I exaggerate for comic effect. But I'm tired of this. When I'm actually stating factual facts, people tell me that I'm exaggerating. I've had it. You're on notice, Miss Kemp. You hear me?
I think you exaggerate sometimes.
Oh, nice. Nice one. All right.
Oh, and I also would like to say that I also consider Harry Potter a guilty pleasure. But, you know, here's the thing. Yeah. I feel that way about a lot of books. There's a lot of stuff out there that's fun to read, that's poorly written, or just is flawed, you know, and it's not, like, great literature. But it's still fun to read, and especially if it has a good plot and there's imaginative things in it, you know, that are sort of fantastical or that give your brain a break. So...
Yeah.
And that's clearly distinct from a great work of literary fiction or nonfiction that does cause you to think a lot and is very intricately written and is very beautiful, but might be not as relaxing a read.
Yeah. All right, Hilary, now you're getting into the spirit of things. Now you're getting the guilty pleasure idea.
Oh, good. I'm so glad that I meet your criteria, Ed.
Oh, shut up. Man, you're such a... Okay, we're going to have to get to you being in bed, because the last two times I've talked to you in bed, you have been a grouch, and this is no exception.
I'm not grouchy. I'm just opinionated.
Yes, you are.
When I'm in bed, apparently in bed, I'm opinionated.
See, you got that right. But you're always opinionated, but you're more grouchy than just opinionated. All right, let's go back and keep listening to this message. Man, this thing's a marathon. Here we go.
Our fundamentalist, but...
Wait a minute. Let's go backwards.
I know that you tend to over-exaggerate things, and maybe that you don't really feel like all Christians are fundamentalist, but there's lots of us Christians, me included, who really are the polar opposite of all the things that the fundamentalists stand for. And by the way, I don't, as far as I know, there's nothing in the Bible that says don't have sex before marriage.
Holy shit. Did you just hear that?
Well, I think it's a perfect illustration of the fact that Christianity is, in fact, a very broad term. And I mean, it's, in my experience, it's a very broad term. And I think it's really funny that people who embrace that religion and embrace that label sort of feel comfortable with it. I mean, I personally am, I don't consider myself Christian. I was raised in one of the Christian sects, so I'm certainly very familiar with it, with one brand of it, and I'm also familiar with other branches of it because I've dated Catholic boys, and I have known Mennonites and Lutherans, and on, but, you know, if I actually was a Christian, I would probably feel really uncomfortable with that label, because that can mean so many things. It's actually not very informative as a term to describe who you are, other than that you believe Jesus Christ was something, someone important, and that could actually mean a lot of different things too. Mm-hmm. So it's very interesting to me. I don't know, maybe it's not that weird. I consider myself part of the queer community, and that's a pretty broad term. But I actually think it's pretty informative, you know? It means I'm not straight. So...
Right.
I don't know.
Right.
I always find it interesting, and I'm not really judgmental. I find it interesting when people want to tell me what their Christianity is, because it really differs. I've got fundamentalist relatives, and their version of Christianity is a far cry from it's okay to fuck around if you're not married. Pardon the use of the F word on the newly cleaned show.
On the what show?
We cleaned the show up some months ago, and I obviously just soiled it. Sorry about that.
Yeah, I got bad news for you. It's been more than a few months. It's been a couple of years, but that's okay. Well, that's pretty fascinating take on the whole thing. I hadn't really thought about it that way. But I also stopped the tape because, honestly, from where I'm coming from, that was a mind-blowing concept that Jesus and Paul would be okay with you having sex outside of marriage. I can't tell you how liberating that was when I heard her say that. Because I thought about it, I thought, yeah, I don't know where it's at in the Bible where it says you have to be married to have sex. So, pretty interesting stuff. I'm sure it's probably in the Old Testament somewhere. I get it from thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's wife, but I don't even know if that's really one of the Ten Commandments, first of all. And second of all, that's about lusting after your wife, after your neighbor's wife, not having sex with somebody you're not married to. So that was a pretty mind-blowing concept. I never really realized that before. So now I'm pretty happy about it.
Well, I gotta ask you though, like, and I'm not sure that I'm gonna be asking the right person this question, but maybe I'll just ask it of you and by proxy other people. Anyone who affiliates themselves with the Christian religion has a tendency, at least, and it's very common for them to say, to refer to the Bible as some sort of important reference. And I find that curious because I get it when fundamentalists refer to the Bible. That's sort of part of the deal. If you're a fundamentalist, you believe a lot of things. And one of the things you believe is that that book is actually the transcribed word of God. And all of the things in it are by and large literally true, even when they contradict each other. Then you just have to tie yourself in philosophical knots explaining it, you know. But when people who consider themselves non-traditional Christians, like it's okay to have sex outside of marriage, for instance, or maybe abortion would be all right, or, you know, maybe same-sex relationships are not so terrible, or something that goes against what a fundamentalist would believe in. In that same sentence, they say, there's nothing in the Bible that says blah, blah, blah. I'm like, why do you care? You know, I mean, the Bible is a document written by human beings, and whether or not it was inspired by God, it's a matter of opinion. If you believe in Christianity, you probably believe that that God was involved in the creation of that document somehow. But people are fallible. So even if you believe that God spoke to someone and that he wrote it down, you know, that person could have written in typos or been crazy, you know, plus we already know that the modern version of the Bible that we actually have in English was created by a king of England for convenience, right? And it's not the original texts that were handed down to the original people who actually wrote it. So I just find this so funny. You know, there's nowhere in the Bible, and I'm not dissing your friend at all, or our biggest fan. All I'm saying is that what's so interesting to me is that even when you're a quote-unquote liberated, non-traditional, modern Christian, there are these sort of unconscious things that you kind of still bring along, like the Bible is the most important. Its most important thing is to say whether or not this thing is in the Bible. We should go look in the Bible to make sure. Or let's use the Bible. Let's argue this point and say, well, it's not in the Bible. Actually, the fundamentalists are just misinterpreting this text. You know? I mean, I kind of get why that is, because without the Bible, what is Christianity? Then you have to ask those questions too, right? Then you have to go and read Aramaic or something. But I found that statement very interesting.
Jeez, holy shit. Man, Hilary, you were awfully lugubrious tonight. even more than usual. All right, well, you know what, man? We are running way over. We're going to take a break and come back and listen to the rest of Hayden's message. We have a new promo. And the promo is none other than from Hayden McManus. So I think we're just going to call this the Hayden McManus Show tonight. Hilary and I will be right back. You're listening to the Edward T. Martin Show featuring the great Hilary Kemp. Here is one of our new promos.
Hi, this is Farmers Insurance Agency owner Hayden McManus. Edward T. and Hilary are so good, I'm not only their number one fan, I've also been a guest on the show. Remember Avatar? If you need insurance in the Puget Sound area, please look me up on Facebook at McManus Agency. But for the best in talk, get the Edward T. Martin podcast featuring Hilary Kemp on iTunes. It will ensure your listening pleasure.
Yes, indeed. That is the McManus Insurance Agency. You betcha. In University Place, Washington. Give our friend Hayden a call. 206-412-6121 is her phone number right there in the Seattle area. If you're listening from the Seattle area, give her a call. She'll give you an insurance quote on anything. That's a fact, Jack. Welcome back. You're listening to the Edward T. Martin Show featuring the great Hilary Kemp. We were listening to none other than Hayden McManus's phone message to us, which was lengthy, informative, and in-depth. Got us talking a whole lot about Christianity. Hilary went on a pretty good Edward T. Martin style rant there just before we went to break. What I wanted to say about that is that one of the things I wanted to point out was when I went on the rant on the previous show that Hayden is referring to, I was indeed talking about the conservative right-wing fundamentalist Christians. That's who I went off on. I don't know. I don't really have a big problem with liberal Christians. I think they're fine. I got no problem with them. It's these, I'll call them Mike Martin types, the people like my dad who just think they have the answer to everything. And if you don't do everything the way they think you should do it, then you're going to hell. And they do everything they can to try and quote unquote save you and get you to give your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you don't, then they don't want anything to do with you. And that just seems like so unchristian-like to me, to condemn you to burn in hell, whatever that is, if you don't agree with them. And really, to me, it's just gotten misconstrued. You know, I was listening to NPR the other day, and there was a really funny quote from a Woody Allen movie, from Hannah and Her Sisters, where Max von Sydow, who plays an artist, is talking about spending the night alone, and he was watching television, and he says something like, "But the worst are the televangelists."
If Jesus came back and saw what's going on in his name, he'd never stop throwing up.
It's a great joke, and I busted a gut when I saw that in the theater years ago. That's from Hannah and Her Sisters, I believe from 1986. And get that movie. It is awesome. Let's keep listening to Hayden's. Do you have anything else, by the way, before we move on?
Well, I do think the concept of hell is interesting. And actually, I've always really loved the quote from Faust, the demon that's tempting the main character says, is asked something about, or is asked why he's outside of hell. And the demon says, why this is hell, nor am I out of it. And it's a really interesting statement. It's a metaphysical statement but basically what it means is anywhere you are that isn't heaven, anywhere that you are where you're not in the grace of God, that sense of being away from God is hell, right?
Wow.
And so then I take that into sort of a secular context, because of course I'm not really religious and I don't necessarily have an opinion about what happens when you die.
Okay.
And I think, you know, hell is a state of being that's achievable on earth.
Yes.
And you can also be in a state of grace on earth. And I think that you don't have to die to be in heaven or hell. It's quite possible to be in those places right here on planet Earth.
Oh, 100%. I mean, when I recorded the show that she's referring to, I was downright suicidal. And I would literally walk to lunch every day. I would leave the office at about noon, somewhere around there, and walk outside, and I walk 3 blocks away to this place that has an atrium where there's a little restaurant. It's a giant office building, and there's this, food court central thing. And I just go there. I take my lunch there. And on my way to the atrium every day, I would say to myself, I am living in hell. I am in hell. I am on earth in hell. I never thought that hell could be on earth, but I was wrong. And I didn't think you could go to hell before you died, but I did.
Right.
The last 18 months of my life have been nothing but hell. All right, man. Let's keep listening to this message. Jeez, I'm getting back to suicidal thoughts already.
So, anyway, my point is that the things that you don't like about Christianity are not really Christianity, in my opinion. They're people being hypocritical and intolerant and not following what Jesus would have taught. So there's my soapbox about Christianity. Finally, I hope you're feeling better than you were when you recorded that show. It's been 3 months, almost 3 months from the time that you recorded it. And I think I would have...
Okay, so at that point, Google Voice cuts her off. Because it has a 3-minute limit. unfortunately, I'm feeling better and feeling worse. I went through an enormous amount of physical pain for 3 months, and then that went away. And then 3 weeks later, I got sick with a cold. And that went away. And then as of about a week ago, I'm having some really strange, weird endocrinology problems with my diabetes. I'm constantly hungry, and it won't go away. And I got to go to the doctor's again tomorrow. So pretty awesome. It's funny, last time you and I recorded, Hilary, I wound up going to the doctor's that week. And that's when all those problems with the nerve pain happened.
Right.
Where the disc in my back bulged, and and I was in the most ferocious pain I'd ever been in 24/7 in my life for 3 months. It was an awesome experience that I never want to repeat. At that point, Hayden calls us back on the phone, and here we go.
Haha, I told you it was going to be a lot of talking. The tape ran out, or whatever time limit on the last message. So anyway, I think I would have heard by now if you would have killed yourself on October 11th, so I hope that didn't happen. And I seem to recall hearing stuff about your birthday that did not include suicide. And I want to argue also with the fact that no one calls you, because I call you, and not just this number, your regular number too. So glad that you think I'm no one there, Mr. Negatory, Negative Nelly all the time.
Yeah, okay. Well, obviously with Hayden, I have to do what I do with Hilary, which is when I say nobody calls me, pardon me for saying nobody. You guys. Yes, sorry if nobody to you means absolutely no one on the entire face of the planet. When I say nobody, I mean I literally go weeks without any single human being calling me on my phone. If it wasn't for my mom, no one would call me. So there. Take that, Hayden and Hilary. Geez. Yeah, so that's what I mean when I say nobody. But I don't know about anybody else out there listening. My mom, if I don't call her for 2 weeks, she'll finally give me a call just to see if I'm still alive. But she's the only one I get a call from. I get return calls if I call people. Hilary, I think you call me every great once in a while, about every 3 weeks or so, yeah, month, maybe.
Yeah, and I do return your calls.
And you do, but my point is, it is a great rarity that someone originates a call and calls me and then says, hey, what are you doing? Do you want to go get a cup of coffee or do something? So,
right.
Jesus, at least people in Seattle used to do that. Yes, I am living in hell. Let's continue.
Anyway, I would be really sad if you committed suicide. And the thing that you were waiting for Hilary to say, I think, when you announced that and she was silent was, don't do it. But also, all of us have said that to you so many times that maybe we feel like we're wasting our breath.
Okay, you are wasting your breath. Stop telling me to don't do it. Because that's not why I'm telling you why I want to do it. I'm telling you I want to do it to get it out of my head so the thought doesn't stay there. Because the person who actually completes the suicide is the person who never talks about it. So that's why it's out there. I'm not asking anybody tell me not to do it. I'm just asking you to listen about how I feel about my life, which especially at that point, I felt absolutely horrible. It's gotten a little better since then. I went to see a therapist the next day. You and I talked on a Sunday, and I went on a Monday. And like I said, that person, that therapist, is making me feel better about myself because she listens and she validates what I say. When I tell her about all the stuff that I went through, from leaving Chicago and living with my dad and having to give away my cat and giving up on my dream of being in radio and working in a job that's traditionally held by middle-aged housewives who are empty nesters or young 18-year-old girls, and how emasculating that is, and not having a car in L.A. Junior, which is what Denver is. When I tell her all these things, she validates me and says, yeah, you're right for feeling that way. You know, you can't stay in that feeling forever. You're going to get stuck, and you got to get out of the anger and the resentment. But just her finally having someone validate, saying you have the right to feel that way. Anybody who had that happen to them would feel that way. Now we can start working on moving on. It was a huge thing. I had worked with a sponsor from a certain program that I go to who would not acknowledge that for me for nothing. He's, oh, well, you know, yeah, you got to turn that over to God, blah, blah, blah. It's like, shut up. Can you just once say, yeah, you should feel that way? I would feel that way. Mm-hmm. But no. So I dumped that MF-er. And that's just the way it goes sometimes. Not everyone's a winner. So, no, I did not expect Hillary to yell out, don't do it. I think Hillary's mind was just blown. And that was what it was. So, still here, still kicking, trying to get out of hell. Here we go.
I'm glad you're in the world. I hope you stay with us a lot longer. And if you want to move back to Seattle, I'll hang out and drink coffee with you.
Aw.
That's very sweet.
It was very sweet. And here's it's very sweet. Thank you, Hayden. I love, Hayden, that you just share your mind the way Hillary and I do. Here's the ending, too. Listen to this.
Okay, that is all. Good day. Doughy bow dumb.
Doughy bow dumb. It's catching fire, folks. that's awesome. So, yeah, there you have it. The Hayden McManus missive. Man, it was huge, and it was awesome, and it was welcomed. Any final thoughts on that, Hillary?
No, I think she spoke her mind very eloquently.
Yeah, I think so, too. Well, thanks, Hayden. There's a reason why you're not our number one fan, because you're pretty smart and savvy, and I really appreciate you leaving that message for us. That all started because we were telling you how to get a hold of us. So, you can also get a hold of us by writing to edwardtmartin@gmail.com. We had an email come in. You want to guess who it was from?
Oh, let me guess. It was Hayden McManus.
It was indeed. Hayden's not the only one who writes in, but she's the only one who's written in since our last show. And actually, this addresses the show where I talked about my sexual abuse, the show that you interviewed me. And she said, hey, Ed, what a powerful show. Thank you again for being so honest. I hope you can add me to the list of people who are supportive around your sexual abuse. I try really hard to be accepting and love you and all my survivor brothers and sisters. Hugs, Hayden McManus. And she left her personal phone number for me. So there you go. Like she said, I call you. So she was insulted. Sorry. All right. And you can find us on the show's website, edwardtmartin.info. You can get us on iTunes. And don't forget to like our Facebook page. That's a pretty easy one, is it not, Hillary?
Very easy.
Yes, it's free and easy.
Best two things in the world, free and easy.
Free. Hillary's favorite.
Close to that is cheap and easy, but free and easy is even better than cheap and easy. So,
yeah, free and easy describes just about any girl I fall in love with. So, it's free and easy. Right, Ed McMahon?
Free and easy. Yes.
That's right. All right. Well, you know, I think, Hillary, this is just going to be the guest star show.
Absolutely.
So, we're going to take a break. When we come back, we're kind of experimenting here. It's 2013, and I want to try some different things. So when we come back, we're going to hear a little missive from Mr. Mayor himself, the Mayor of Queen Anne, my dear friend, Tim Malloy. We'll listen to what he has to say when we come back. This is the Edward T. Martin Show featuring the great Hillary Kemp.
Hi, this is Bart Shore, host of Time Warp Radio, where I play songs from the 50s, 60s, and 70s. On Sunday, there's a one-hour request show. The show's on my website at bartshore.com, your daily trip to great rock and roll songs of the past. When you're not listening to Time Warp Radio, get the Edward T. Martin Show on iTunes. Download it, and you've got it anytime, anywhere. Be sure to tell all your friends.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Edward T. Martin Show. Yeah, that's right, Bart Shore. Check out Bart Shore at Time Warp Radio. I think you'll dig what he's got to say and what he's got to play. Because Bart is a DJ from way back. He's been in the business forever. Bart, just an awesome guy. and really knows his stuff about music. So check out Time Warp Radio. All right. Well, we're back. And as promised, I have queued up a new segment that I like to call A Few Minutes with Mr. Mayor. That's right. The Mayor of Queen Anne, the prophet himself, Tim Malloy, the self-anointed prophet. My old friend from Queen Anne. And Tim goes political on us for his first ever debut rant. Here we go. A Few Minutes with Mr. Mayor. And I'm not going to be stopping this one, or the show is going to be 3 hours long. Here we go.
All right, Martin and Kemp. This may not really reach you guys as too political where you are, but up here in God's country in the Northwest, fight, fight, fight. Coal trains, 125 of them in each train filled, coming from Montana or Wyoming railroad train track to the new Gateway Terminal out of Bellingham. Also, they want to build one in Longview and Grays Harbor. The one in Olympia got killed thanks to the anarchists. But, yeah, go ahead and give me your opinion on shipping Wyoming coal out of the U.S. so they can burn it in China for electricity. I myself, these are good union jobs we can have. The environmental protections are protection on top of protection. Well, I mean, I got a degree in this stuff, but it's environmental law and regulation is too much regulation. Gotta cut some of that back. There's an article in the Seattle Times dated January 2nd by Bruce Ramsey. What is he saying? Awareness of global warming is several decades old, and Seattle's proud to be a leader. We drive hybrid cars. We recycle our garbage. We vote Democrat. We're good, no? No, says Peter Ward, professor of biology. Blah, blah, blah. And Ward goes on to complain about the coal trains going to China because it's just going to continue global warming. But we're in a quandary. We have thousands of well-paying union jobs. And if China does not buy our coal, they're going to buy it from Australia. Known fact. So if we can cover up the coal bins, the coal trains, so there's no dust flying around, and it slows everybody down in Seattle for a couple more minutes a day, which I think is a good thing. Too much hustling around, too many heart attacks, too many people have accidents. Just sit, get into a Seattle yoga pose until the train goes by and you're peaceful, breathing right, doing well. All right, well, back to this boner, Peter Ward. You know, Peter Ward lives with his wife and his kid in a 75-year-old house with an oil furnace. He drives a hybrid, though hybrid buying one makes it does little to save the earth because of the environmental cost of making the car. Most have nickel and metal hydride batteries and the ultimate cost of disposal. So what happens to a 20-year-old hybrid when you're done driving it? We don't know. But this guy, Mr. High and Mighty, says we shouldn't ship coal. We ought to just let it sit there. So, should be interesting, but, hey, Ed and Hilary, why don't you talk about that? You live in the area where we're mining some of the coal coming to the Northwest that we want to ship to China. we're going to have to build these terminals, offloading, loading, maintenance, a lot of jobs. 4,000 was my estimate. Anyway, hope that does it for you. Seattle, Washington, 34 degrees. I will catch you on the flip side. Until then, Tim the Prophet Malloy with his coal terminal political commentary. Until then, that is all.
But I know that there's a bad boy underneath that Ned Flanders. Mr. Mayor.
So there you have it. The Prophet, Mr. Mayor, the Mayor of Queen Anne himself, my dear old friend Tim Malloy, going totally social political on us for his debut piece. Holy mackerel. What do you think of that, Hilary? You're in Seattle. I'll give you my piece here in a second.
It's a good question. I've been thinking about this kind of stuff since I was a kid, because where I'm from, that's in Canada, there's actually a lot of natural resources. Right. Not a lot of people compared to the amount of natural resources. So there's been historically a lot of employment in mining, extracting oil, fisheries.
Okay. Sure.
Logging was a big one. And the logging is the one that was what I first started thinking about when I was a kid, because, you know, logging has a lot of pros and cons, and there was a big debate between the loggers and the people who were trying to preserve the forests, because I don't know how much you know and people who are listening, but I mean, the forests of British Columbia in particular are beautiful and, you know, often old growth or fairly old growth rainforests. So, you know, you've got the people trying to cut the trees down and make money and
right.
feed their families, which is a right. totally legit thing to want to do just as an individual person. And then
Absolutely.
You've got the people who are worrying about the decimation of the environment. And I mean, Canada is known for its natural beauty, and these kinds of activities do destroy that. They destroy the environment and they destroy ecosystems. And, you know, you can try to be smarter about it, but you're still cutting down trees. And
yeah.
I have yet to see a logging operation. I mean, it may exist now, or people may make that argument. I really am not buying it, but I have yet to see a logging operation that's so careful that it doesn't do any damage to the environment that the trees are coming out of.
Okay.
So, you know, mining, I know a lot less about, but I do know that mines pretty much universally destroy the earth that they're taking stuff out of.
Okay, and but is that such a bad thing?
Is it bad to destroy environments? I mean, I guess that's a yeah. matter of opinion.
If you're destroying it but doing something purposeful with it and not leaving it entirely scarred, is that a bad thing? Especially, and this is what Tim was referring to, is that I am from the area that they get that coal. They get that coal from Wyoming.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people, when they think of Wyoming, they think of Jackson Hole and they think of Yellowstone National Park, but that is in the far northwest part of the state of Wyoming. And man, if you've ever been through Wyoming, it has the lowest population of any state in the Union, and there's a reason for that. It is incredibly barren, ugly land where the wind blows all the time. And for any sane human being to spend any time in that area is almost illogical. And I don't know if you're taking minerals out of the ground, it's such a bad thing in an area like that.
Yeah.
Anyway, but what do you think about the part where he's talking about coal that pollutes, and most importantly, coal trains going through your beloved Seattle?
Well, you know, I mean, I'm not sure that I have an opinion about coal trains coming through Seattle. I doubt that it's going to have much of a bad environmental impact for the coal to exist here momentarily.
Yeah.
So then
right.
what you're talking about is ethics versus jobs. You know, is it worth the jobs that we'll get in the transport business,
mm-hmm.
Weigh that against, you know, whether if we should be shipping coal to anybody, you know, whether we should be using coal for anything. I mean, coal right. is notoriously polluting when you try to make energy out of it. It just isn't. Right. And the technology has definitely gotten better. But I yeah. wouldn't say, just like with the logging, you know, I've never seen a logging operation that I wouldn't say that I would buy the argument that no damage is being done. I have yet to see a coal-fired electricity producing plant that does no damage. I mean, it's a pretty dirty form of energy still. So I don't know. I think it's really complicated. I'm not sure that I have a simple opinion on it. I think China's a big place. They are using a lot of electricity, and they're sure they're going to get their coal from someplace. That's going to turn into pollution. That's going to affect the people living there and ultimately the whole planet.
Mm.
So, you know, I don't think it's a simple thing. I don't know that I can actually have a simple opinion on it. I think we're in a sad state. Actually, environmentally, I think we're in a sad place right now. I think our planet is in a precarious place that is probably extraordinarily difficult to rectify, even if we started today doing extreme things that politically would never fly.
Hmm.
So I have a friend actually who has described it as, she's like, you know, she's like, the ship has sailed. We're going
yeah.
down.
Yeah.
And I, you know, you can argue whether or not that's true, but it's a complicated question. And if the ship indeed has sailed, then who the hell cares? Just send the coal wherever you want. You know
right,
what I mean?
Right. You just nailed the point for me. And for once, we actually agree that I, too, agree that it's a complicated issue without any simple answers. By the way, Mr. Mayor, thanks for bringing that up. I am on two sides on this one. It really is complicated because I'm all with Tim. I'm a union guy, and I'm all for making jobs for the United States, even if we're shipping our own coal over to China. I got no problem with shipping minerals to other countries. They're buying the stuff. We have it. This is how world economies are based, right? And I'm all, like I said, for the working man getting a job. And I think that's a good thing. And if the people of Seattle are inconvenienced and have to wait, well, all I got to say is what's new? Good Lord. I don't remember waiting as much anywhere as I did in Seattle. Good Lord in heaven, man. It's such one thing about Denver. It is such a pleasure to be here because people roll up to the light and they don't even come to a full stop. If it's a red light and they're making a right turn, they just kind of come to a roll. If there's no traffic coming, boom, they're gone. They make the right turn. You can cross against a red light in this town when you're walking. You don't have to wait for the walk signal or worry about getting a ticket from a cop for jaywalking, of all things. My God, Seattle, you're such a bunch of pussies. Cops here got way bigger fish to fry than jaywalking. So if people in Seattle have to wait while these trains go through, well, more power to the trains, I say, because you people could stand to wait a little bit more. You live in a completely backwards town when it comes to traffic, when it comes to transportation, and when it comes to making improvements in your transportation infrastructure. Give me a break. You've been trying to build the tunnel for how long now? They're talking about building the tunnel when I moved to Seattle, and that was in 2004. They still have not built the tunnel. It is now 2013. So going on 10 years. Awesome. They expanded I-25 in this town in 7 years. The project was supposed to take 9. They did it in 7. I got to hand it to Denver. They got the transportation thing down. So speaking of Denver, the other problem is last summer we had 9 days where it was 100 degrees plus. 100 degrees plus could be 103. It could be 109. It was an unbelievably horrible summer. We had 70 plus days of 90 plus degree days. These temperatures are records that are unheard of and unmatched and unparalleled. I saw an article in the New York Times today alone. Today is the 9th of January, 2013. And they said, no surprise, 2012 hit the all-time record for high temperatures. I heard an interview on NPR a few months ago. They talked to a guy who for 20 years was the science reporter for Time magazine. He's not just some fruitcake left-wing nut job from Seattle. He's an actual science reporter. And he left Time magazine and started specializing his reporting in climatology. And at the end of the interview, Dave Davies, who was filling in for Terry Gross on Fresh Air, said, if you had anything you want to say to our audience before we close, what would you say? And he said, I would say that if you're enjoying this summer's temperatures, get used to it, because this is just the start. And that put a stake through my heart. That chilled me to the bone when he said that, because it was right in the middle of summer when I was listening to that, and I was dying from the heat here. It was just a horrible summer. And according to him, this is just the beginning. So I'm with you. I agree that we have completely effed our planet. And since we already have, what the hell? Do it. Sell the coal to China. I agree with your friend. I think it's too late. They were talking about this back in 1984 when I was working at Medco Supply in Boulder, Colorado. And I remember hearing about it then, and I thought they would have done something about it by 1995. And they've done nothing. And they still continue to do nothing. And I would like to thank Rupert Murdoch and the News Corporation for hiding all the evidence and information from all their viewers. Thank you, Rupert Murdoch. Go F yourself. So, and I'm sure Murdoch is scared of me.
Absolutely.
And listens to everything I say.
Oh, I'm so scared.
So there you have it. A few minutes with Mr. Mayor. Now, I just wanted to say, if you're listening to Tim there, please know that Tim is, he has Parkinson's disease and got it at a pretty early age. He was in his early 40s and he had a battery implant put in his chest, an actual battery about the size of a pack of cigarettes. He had a battery put into his chest that's about the size of a pack of cigarettes, and the wires from the battery go up to his brain and affect the motion, the part of the brain that affects motion. It sends electrical impulses to keep him from shaking, because that's one of the main symptoms of Parkinson's, is the way people shake. Are you with me, Hilary?
I am.
You're a scientist. Yeah, so the problem with that is it makes Tim talk really slow, really
right.
Slow, to the point where you've met Tim, and he has to grab his throat and kind of massage it as he talks to get the words to come out. And when he recorded this, here's the weird thing. If anybody out there knows anything about this, please contact us here at the show, edwardtmartin@gmail.com, 660-386-0077. When he takes Ambien to go to sleep at night, which he sometimes does, he can talk almost normally. That recording you just heard was recorded after he had taken an Ambien about a half an hour later. And right before the sleepy effects hit him, he can talk almost completely normally, which that was right there. So,
yeah.
Is that not weird? And he and I have talked about this for a couple of years now, but we would just love to find out what the side agent is that allows him to talk. And if you could isolate
that he could stay awake.
You know,
I'm willing to bet that somebody knows this, and we should do a show on it, because, you know, I don't know if we've covered this, but my new job, my project is on Parkinson's.
Wow. Maybe you could bring Tim as a test subject.
Well, it's really not in humans, so it would,
oh, darn it.
What I'm learning is not going to be of immediate benefit to him.
Yeah, really? Well, that sucks. All right. Well, the world's going to hell anyway, so why don't you just start cutting into him and find out what's going on and cure him, and we'll all go out with a bang. And I mean a bang, not like an explosion, but if you get my drift here. So.
I think I might get your drift. And,
yeah. I'm not talking about...
politely decline.
I am not talking about having sex with you. Trust me. That is not happening.
You're talking about having sex with Tim.
Yeah, sure. Why not?
All right. There we go.
Tim and like six girls. Yeah. I'm talking about a gangbang orgy.
He's just in the room somewhere around.
Yeah, no, yeah, I'm not touching him. No way. But, yeah, he's
like... He's got, like, a high female-to-male ratio.
Yeah, he's on one side of the room, I'm on the other. We're looking at each other and giving each other a thumbs up, and life's good, and then the planet burns up, and we all evaporate into the atmosphere. But we go out with a bang. So, there you have it. Well, let's take one more break, and we'll come right back and wrap the show up. This is the Edward T. Martin Show, featuring the great Hilary Kemp.
Hi, this is Lori Hardy, life coach. If you want to get some things done with your life, I can help you out with that. I've certainly helped Edward T. out with a few of his goals. Check out CoachLori.com. And don't forget, you can get the Edward T. Martin Show on iTunes. Just go to the iTunes store, then podcasts, and type in Edward T. Martin Show. It's easy. And if you subscribe, you'll never miss another show. Oh, and by the way, tell all your friends, Edward T. Martin on iTunes.
Welcome back, everybody, to the Edward T. Martin Show. Yeah, that, you know who that was. That was Lori Hardy. That's right. Lori was our last guest on the show, as a matter of fact, if you recall, and I'm sure you do. So thanks for that, Lori, and make sure and check out her websites, Coach Lori, and Did Not See That Coming. All right. Well, Hilary, at the beginning of the show, we said that you were at the Kemp Mansion on the first floor in bed.
Absolutely.
Why are you at home in bed?
I had a little surgery.
Mm-hmm. What kind?
I had a little abdominal surgery, so I'm off of work for some weeks. And so
You into a guy?
Yes. Finally? Yes. It was finally the the FTM surgery that I've been waiting for. So absolutely. Well,
we both determined that you're more of a man than I am, so why not? And as much as I get laid, I'll donate my penis. What the hell?
That is incredibly sweet and weird. Thank you.
You're welcome. You had surgery. It's true. I haven't gotten laid in over 10 years. What the hell? So we've already determined that the planet's going to blow up. And we're all going to hell. And I'm not getting laid. So since with all those facts being facts, which they aren't, why not just give you my penis? What bigger sacrifice could a man give to a woman than what better way could he say he loves her by giving her his dick and not in the way that that phrase would indicate?
Well, why did you know, you have we are conversing in my bed right now, so it's all there. You go. It's a wild show.
That's right. I said the show is partly from Denver, but it's not. I'm laying next to Hilary right now, getting ready to cut off my penis. Hilary, why did you have surgery?
I had some growths in my uterus.
Wow. What kind of growth?
They're non-cancerous tumors. So they just, you know, hanging out.
Well, good.
Need to get
good.
Rid of them.
They were non-cancerous, but they were tumors.
Yeah, they're really not dangerous at all. Uh-huh. They're just, you know.
But what, they were getting uncomfortable? They were pushing into other parts of your body? What was going on?
Exactly. So, okay. You know, people have different symptoms. I got to the point where I was ready to be done with them. So I had a chat with a surgeon, and here we are.
Okay.
6 weeks in which I'm not allowed to lift my heavy cat.
Oh, that sucks. How's your cat taking it?
You know, he seems all right. We still cuddle, and, you know, it's all good.
Yeah, good. Well, at least you get to cuddle with your cat. I love the cats. So you're feeling okay?
I am. I'm doing really well.
Are you on any pain medication?
I am on pain medication.
Nice. And what are you on?
Percocet.
Ooh.
Good stuff.
Really good stuff. What else? Tell me more.
Other than that, I just take ibuprofen.
Oh, good.
Yep.
And things seem to be progressing okay?
Indeed they are.
What's the prognosis?
The prognosis is I will live.
Good. You had to take some time off of work?
I did.
How much?
Well, you know, I'm still off work now, so that is yet to be determined.
How long have you been off?
I have been off for 3 weeks today.
Wow. Sucky way to get that much time off of work. Especially over the holiday season.
Yeah, and that was kind of the point. I wanted to do it over the holidays so that my absence would be less noticeable.
Sure, sure. All right. How are your pain levels?
I'm actually doing great.
Good. Is that because you're on the is that because you're on the Percocet or because the pain's going away?
It is definitely going away.
Good. All right, buddy. Anything else you want to say about that?
You know, I'm just grateful for all of the good care that I've had.
Well, right on. Yeah. Well, I know you're pretty obstinately private about your private life. So thanks for sharing that with us on the show, because I know you don't like that too much. You're welcome. The other hand, you're welcome. Thank you, Hilary. Me, on the other hand, I take the don't ask, don't tell policy. If you don't ask me, I really won't tell you. But if you ask me, I'll tell you anything. I'm an open book. What do you say we wrap up the show with a media minute?
It sounds great.
All right, here we go.
Living color.
Yes, my friends, and welcome to another Media Minute. Today, Hilary, I'm going to do something on the Media Minute. I'm going to do two things that I have never done on the Media Minute. Would you care to guess what they are?
Let's see. I'm stumped. You're going to try to walk and chew gum at the same time?
Well, I still can't do that. Number one, I am going to recommend something from the 21st century.
Oh.
If you can believe that. Number two, I am going to recommend a book. Me, Mr. ADD, Mr. I can't even say the word. What's the word where you get the letters confused and they flip back and forth?
Dyslexic.
Thank you. So yes, I am officially diagnosed ADD. I am unofficially diagnosed dyslexic. I took a little test online one time and went, oh, that's why I don't like to read. Letters bounce around all the time. I just thought everybody had that. So I found out they don't. Today, I would like to recommend a book by Malcolm Gladwell. Now, I am not introducing anything new into the lexicon, I'm sure, of our society. After reading up on Mr. Gladwell for this show, comes to find out he is a multiple New York Times bestseller. multiple New York Times bestselling author. He is a prolific writer, a staff writer at the New York Magazine, New Yorker. He is a prolific writer and a staff writer with the New Yorker Magazine since 1996. He has won several awards and was named in 2005 as one of Time Magazine's 100 most influential people. He's the author of a book called The Tipping Point and another book called Blink. The former from the year 2000, the latter from the year 2005. Today's book I want to recommend is called Outliers, The Story of Success, from 2008. Outliers was actually recommended to me by my boss at the law firm, and it blew my mind. It is a mind-blowing book. The reason I recommend it on this show is I kind of figure people listening to the show may not be as in tune with bestsellers, kind of the way I am. I figure if people listen to the show, they might think like I do. If they think like I do, they may not read books the way I do. Not. So did that make sense?
No.
Regardless. Okay. regardless, my boss recommended it to me, and I recommend anything because it speaks to me personally. And this book spoke to me louder than anything I've seen probably in the last 10 years. So on his website, I went and did some research, and an outlier is a scientific term to describe things or phenomena that lie outside of normal experience. Gladwell says that he's interested in people who are outliers, men and women who, for one reason or another, are so accomplished and so extraordinary and so outside of ordinary experience, they are puzzling to the rest of us. And so he goes on to talk about the Beatles and Bill Gates and these kind of people who are astonishingly successful. And he says the book grew out of a frustration I found myself having with the way we explain the careers of really successful people. You know how you hear someone say of Bill Gates or some rock star or some other outlier, they're really smart, or they're really ambitious. Well, I know lots of people who are really smart and really ambitious, and they aren't worth $60 billion. It struck me that our understanding of success was really crude, and there was an opportunity to dig down and come up with a better set of explanations. And man, does he ever. So I strongly recommend this book to you, because basically what he says is there are several factors going on. One is the 10,000 hour rule, which basically says that you must do something for 10,000 hours before you become an expert at it.
Well, that totally makes sense to me.
Doesn't it, though?
Yeah.
Another thing he says, and this is where I really began to love this book, because that just makes sense. But where I began to love this book is he was talking about you have to have a supportive community surrounding you to be successful also. And you can probably guess why that spoke so loud to me.
Indeed, I can.
There you go. Because with the exception of people like you and Lori Hardy and the mayor of Queen Anne, Tim Malloy, and J.P. Giuliani, a frequent guest on this show, with the exception of people like that, I do not get a whole lot of support from a whole lot of people to pursue what I believe I could be eventually an expert at, which is, of course, doing the radio and voice thing. Instead, people are always trying to steer me away from it, and they have for years and years and years. And it just like, man, it was like the clouds parting in the Blues Brothers, and the sun hits Jake Blues right in the face, and he starts yelling, "The band! The band!
The band!
Do you see the light? The band! Do you see the light?
What light?
Have you seen the light?
Yes! Yes! Jesus H. God damn it, Christ! I have seen the light!"
And you can probably guess why I'm not commenting on that, because I haven't seen that film and I have no idea what you're talking about.
Hilary, my subsection media minute recommendation, The Blues Brothers, still to this day, it holds up well 30 years later. It is a brilliantly funny film. So just like Jake Blues, all of a sudden I realized part of the problem is I have not surrounded myself with a supportive community, that indeed the outliers in my life are supporters. They are relatively few, far, and in between. And so it helped me explain like my lack of success that I feel in my life and why I feel like I'm in hell. And the third part he talks about is luck, just pure, flat out MFing luck. And in the last 18 months, I've had a little bit of luck of getting a job at the law firm and them actually liking me. Other than that, I would say not a whole lot of luck. Here is an audio clip from the Charlie Rose Show. This is the author, Malcolm Gladwell, in 2009, talking to PBS talk show host Charlie Rose, interviewer extraordinaire, talking to Malcolm Gladwell about luck.
Luck is a huge theme in this book, and it's funny. And you know, we're not very good with luck. We either, you know, we tend to sort of discount it. We'd always rather give a kind of considered explanation for something than just to say it's happenstance. But you know what? A lot of the time, it really is. And I try and, you know, in the book, I try and sort of zero in on what is exactly the nature of the lucky break that characterizes so much of truly outstanding success.
Okay, let's take an easy example that you use. Mm-hmm. Bill Gates.
Yeah, so Bill Gates is lucky in many ways.
Yeah, very bright.
He starts two ways in particular. One is that when he walks into eighth grade at Lakeside Academy in Seattle in 1968, there is a computer terminal sitting there with a link into a mainframe in downtown Seattle. No one had access to a computer terminal in eighth grade or ninth grade or 10th grade or even college in 1968.
Anywhere else in the world.
No, and he himself told me, he's like, if there were 50 people in my position in 1968, I'd be stunned. And he basically spends his entire teenage years programming, right? Because of this gift. And he would tell me, at one point, Paul Allen, his great high school buddy,
right,
with whom he co-founds Microsoft, discovers there's a mainframe down at University of Washington that's free, it's not being used, between 2 and 6 in the morning. So he goes to bed at 10 o'clock, sets the alarm clock, climbs out of the window, whatever, at 1:30 in the morning, walks 2 miles to the University of Washington, and programs from 2 till 6. Now, I love that story because it's the two parts of his success that are right there. One is the extraordinary desire and obsessiveness and determination and love of computing. But the other is the fact that he's a guy who lives 2 miles from a mainframe in 1973 that's free between 2 and 6 in the morning, okay, right? Now, lots of people may have the first thing. Almost no one has the second thing, right? I could have walked for a month and not come on to a mainframe.
Right, but this is central to what you're saying here.
So Charlie and Malcolm go on to talk about the 10,000-hour rule, where they bring the Beatles in, is where they say the Beatles had a chance to stay where they were at in Liverpool or go to Hamburg, Germany and play at a strip club. But at the strip club, they had to play for 8 hours a day. And so instead of playing cover tunes and the occasional original song, they had to come up with a ton of songs to play for 8 hours a day without driving themselves crazy with repetition. So they not only learned and mastered their instruments, but they also got really good at writing new songs. By the time they returned to England in the early 60s, the rest is history. They conquered the United States in 64. They were the first band out of England to do so. I remember years ago reading a book about the Beatles, and the opinion at the time was that a band called Jerry and the Pacemakers was going to be the band that conquered America. And they
who I have heard of, by the way.
There you go. Jerry and the Pacemakers have a great song called Ferry Cross the Mersey. It is a beautiful song that'll just rip your heart out. It's such a great song.
So ferry cross the Mersey, 'cause this land's the place I love. And here I'll stay. And here I'll stay. Here I'll stay.
But poor Jerry and the Pacemakers, they came over to the United States in 1963 and got their ass kicked and had a terrible time and couldn't get anybody to come see their shows or the radio stations to play their music, and went home with their tail between their legs for the rest of their career. And 1 year later, the rest is history. February 1964, here comes the Beatles, Ed Sullivan, it's all over. So there you have it. Malcolm Gladwell is his name. Outliers is the game. That is the name of his book. I got it at the library. It's been around for a while. You should have no trouble finding it. I can't recommend it enough. It is a life changer for me and has given me new hope to stay alive, to understand the areas that I'm weak and why I have failed, and given me a new hope for success. If I could ever get my body to start working right again, could be I could make it. So got a doctor's appointment tomorrow. I'm hungry all the time, no matter how much I eat. I can't get the hungry feeling to go away. So imagine lying in bed at 3 o'clock in the morning and you're voraciously hungry, like there's a tiger in your stomach. You know that great feeling that comes when you're really hungry and you eat something like, and you get that relief and it finally goes away?
Yeah.
I actually am
reminded of when I can't even remember how long ago it was. It was probably 15 or 20 years ago. I heard of a condition that's a genetic, like chronic, lifelong condition in children.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it starts in childhood, obviously. Mm-hmm. And I don't remember what the reason for it is, like what the mm-hmm. genetic reason is. But there's some problem where the kid's hungry all the time.
Oh my God.
It's actually, and this is not intended to be associated with you in any way, it's associated with mental retardation and a bunch of other problems. But one of the key features is this like constant hunger. Like there's no sense of satiation.
Right. 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 And that came on in me last Thursday night. All of a sudden, I had ate dinner and I went to bed and I woke up about 1 o'clock in the morning and I was starving. And I got up and ate something, and usually that happens every great once in a while, about once every 2 or 3 weeks or so. It happens in the middle of the night, and I just eat something, and it goes away, and I go to bed. And this has happened since the late 90s. And but like I said, it's only every now and then. And the switch got thrown on Thursday night, and it will not turn off. So it's awesome. I get woken up about 3 o'clock in the morning, and I'm hungry in hell, and I eat something, and the feeling doesn't go away, and I can't sleep. So I'm getting run down. I'm starting to feel like a sleep deprivation experiment. I'm losing my mind, man. I'm so tired, and I can't sleep. So there you have it. And that, my friends, is the Media Minute. Hilary, thanks so much for taking out time, not only carve out time to do this, but do it while you're sick. And I give you shit about being grumpy, but I really care about you, and I love you, man. And I am glad you're okay, and I'm always glad for you to join me on the show. And
always a pleasure.
Give me
feedback.
And
I want to especially thank you for joining me in bed today.
I couldn't be happier. Especially since I got to give you my penis.
Right.
So, if anybody just started listening to the show right at that point, they are going to be so mind blown right now. All right. Well, I feel like I had so much more to say, but we've already gone over way long, and I am so tired. But most likely won't be able to sleep. So, wish me luck at the doctor tomorrow. Hopefully, she knows what's going on, and she can do something about it. Because being hungry for the rest of my life is not something I would want. All right. Hilary, any final words before we wrap up?
No, but I can say if it's possible for you to ship some of that appetite to my house and give it to my cats who currently are sick and not eating, I would really appreciate it.
Huh, really? That's too bad.
Otherwise, I'm going to keep having to pill them, which is a pain in the ass. But I'm giving them appetite boosters right now.
That sucks, man. Well, I hope they feel better soon. Well, at least my cat's
doing
well.
I hope everybody feels better. Feeling better for everyone.
Yeah, here's to a better 2013. Mine's already started off with a hitch.
Here. I'll drink water to that.
Okay, me too. All right, man. Well, get us on Stitcher.com. Just go to Stitcher.com and download the app. Listen to us on your phone. You can listen to radio stations and other audio products from all over the entire United States and the world. That is not a lie, and that is not an exaggeration. Thank you very much. Call us and leave us a message like Hayden did, a six-minute message, 660-386-0077. And don't forget to drop us a line at edwardtmartin@gmail.com. Give us your feedback. Let us know what you think. Give us suggestions for the show. We could really use your input and ideas. I never have any idea how good or bad we're doing. Never. So it's always good to get people's feedback and let us know. So that's it. We're out of time. We're out of here. Thanks, Hilary, for joining me. This is Edward T. Martin saying common sense is not as common as you think it is. Doughy bow dumb. Coming into the home stretch.
That's right.
I got a media minute. Do you have your science minute on viruses? Even though we never got to talk about sickness.
You know, I want to save that for an actual show where we talk about sickness. So you go ahead. You go on with your bad media minute self.
Jeez, listen to you, man. I'm going to put this on as an extra at the end of the show. You are such a grouch. What medication are you on?
That's not me being grouchy. That isn't intended to be a deprecating comment.
You go ahead with your, you go back and I'm going to send this to you, and you go back and listen to the tone of your voice.
You know, the word bad as slang in that context is actually means good. I don't know if you were aware of this.
Yeah, but I'm talking about the tone of your voice. I'm telling you, I'm going to send you the clip and send it back to you. You listen to it. All right. Do you want to talk about why you're at home in bed, by the way? Because we said we would talk about it at the beginning.
Oh, and then we'll... I briefly, because I would rather do a whole show on that, like, topic. And we can throw all the details.
Yeah, I know. I'm not talking about the topic. I'm just talking about you, why you are at home in bed. All right, here we go. 3, 2, 1.